welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church on this 8th Sunday after Pentecost. We will have a children's message today. The three Papani children will come forward at that time, and then we'll have that done. And we're doing the traditional worship service of prayer and preaching. We also thank Karen Green and Laura Lee Fink for singing into the mics this evening. And we'll sing all of the stanzas of the verses of the hymns.
I made the stars at night.
first reading from the 7th chapter of Deuteronomy. For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his treasured possession out of all the peoples who are on the face of the earth. It was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love on you and chose you. For you were the fewest of all peoples. But it is because the Lord loves you and is keeping the oath that he swore to your fathers, that the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to a thousand generations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the second reading from the 8th chapter of Romans. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called, and those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I'm sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord. We continue with our special music, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Thank you.
Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who, on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the close of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you noticed all these things?" They said to him, "Yes." And he said to them, "Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old." This is the holy gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant, or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Boys and girls, you may now come forward for the message which I have prepared for you. And while the children come forward, we sing, "Celebrate This Child." So good things and the bad things, all those things. Well, you know, you've been seeing a lot of people walking around with masks on. Have you seen that? Yes. And if we look out here today, we see a lot of people with masks on too. Well, I never ever wore a mask before in my life until I was in Florida and my son was in the hospital. And every time I went into the room, I had to put a mask on and a paper roll. When I left the room, I had to put hand sanitizer on. When I came back in, I had to put hand sanitizer on, and a different, a new one, and a new coat, and so on. But we made the best of it, and everything is going really, really well with our son, and he is well. Now, everybody's wearing these masks. Some of the members have been very, very friendly, and they've given us some masks. This mask here, we wear it this way. You know why? So that we see the white part, and if there's some dirt on it, we see it. If it was on the blue, we wouldn't see it as well. Then I got this mask. Now, this is really a mask. My grandson and a friend brought these masks over and toilet paper way back in March. They said, we're delivering these items to the old folks. And I thought, oh my goodness, I didn't think I was that old. 59 years old, but I was considered old by my grandson. So they're making deliveries, four rolls of toilet paper and some masks. So we took them, and here it is. And it's a tight one, I'll tell you, it does its job, believe me. Here it is, it even has a piece of foam here for my nose. So it feels good. Yeah. And guess what? One of the members made this for me. What's on there? Footprints. Are those your footprints? Are those footprints of a human? What are they footprints of? A puppy. Everybody knows we have two dogs. Yes, Mr. Bates is one of the names, and Lola is the other name. Guess who is the oldest of the two? Lola, of course. Then one of the members sent me five pieces of material over the internet. And they said, Pastor Zirpel, I'm going to make you a mask. Which color do you want? And of course, purple. You know that's my favorite color. Do you know why purple is my favorite color? Do you know why? And it's purple on both sides. I can't complain though, right? Make the best out of it. It's going to have to be washed every time I wear it because I don't know if there's germs on there or not. Well, purple rhymes with my last name, Zirpel. Purple Zirpel. So purple is my favorite color. And I chose it right away. She had it then. She didn't know that. Wow, I thought this is what God wants me to have. And here it is. Who's? Your mom. We could be twins, couldn't we? You bet. Okay. So remember this, folks. Remember this, children. God always works everything out. All the things that happen to us, God always works them out for us when we put them all together. Let us pray with both our hands. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for reminding us today that everything that happens is in this world, everything that happens to us personally, Lord, it's always going to be a better day tomorrow or next week or down the road or what have you. And we know, Lord, that we'll be in heaven with you one day. Amen. Okay, go back to your seats.
Lord, let me lift up those who are
Amen. Well, our text for this evening poses some life-changing questions for us to consider. We're all familiar with some of the most basic questions of life. For example, who, what, where, how, when, why. These questions deal with the basic facts and basic information. Important, not always life-changing, depending on the situation. Other questions are life-changing. What college will you go to? What do you want to do when you grow up? Will you marry me? How should you treat this health situation? Then there are the purpose questions. Who am I? Where am I going? What will become of me? What's my purpose for being here right now on this day? And then finally, perhaps there are faith questions. Jesus asks, "Do you love me?" And this question is colored by another. "Do you trust me?" These are the sorts of questions that will really change our life, even our eternal life. It's these types of real life-changing questions that our text this evening addresses. The first question Paul raises in the epistle lesson is simply this: what then shall we say to these things? Or we might say, or about these things. What things? Well, all things. Well, as it turns out, there's a lot of things to say about certain subjects, especially in these past couple of months. Things to say about the church, what to do. Things about what to do about work. Things about, do I go to the grocery store? I had a member just 2 days ago ask me if it was safe to go to Sam's Club. I said, well, I've been there, but I've been wearing a mask. I've been wearing a mask going to Fairway or Hy-Vee or Sam's Club, even when we went to Kohl's a couple weeks because my casual shoes broke out on the side. Never had a pair of shoes do that before the front wore out or, you know, polishing, but you know, you got to deal with it. But I said, I think it's safe. I feel safe when I go to Sam's Club, and on and on. So depending on what's going on in our lives, what shall we say about or to these things? All things. In last week's epistle, Paul talked about creation, we ourselves groaning and suffering the effects of the sin-corrupted world and longing for the glory that's to be revealed to us in the future. Lots of things aren't pretty in this fallen world. What then shall we say in the face of those things? All those things. And some of us, those things are different than, for some of us, those things. Some of those things bother us differently than those things might bother you, and so on. What then shall we say in the face of those things? All those things, including the unpretty ones. This is what Paul says to those things. We know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. So we often quote this verse to encourage people who are suffering. Well, when we look around and we think about ourselves and we're here this evening, are we suffering compared to other people who are suffering, compared to some people that you're thinking about right now in your minds or maybe even holding in your hearts? We really don't probably have a right to say that we're suffering right now. And so, when we tell them that all things work together for good, would you dare do that? Would you dare tell someone that all things work together for good when they are really, really, really suffering and really, really, really hurting compared to what you are going through. So we fail to make clear that it's God who has power to bring good out of bad, who transforms the Good Fridays into Easter. When we say all things work together for good, it sounds as if we believe all things to be good, that we're counting as insignificant the circumstances that caused the pain. Therefore, all things work together for good comes across as a platitude, as if we are saying, well, don't sweat it, it's going to be okay. We shouldn't be surprised if the sufferer dismisses our good intentions and dismisses us as spiritual caregivers as well. The real point of the verse is we know that God works in all things. Try and keep that in mind. Every single day when you get up and you look in the mirror, God works in all things. Or God causes all things to work together for good. God isn't the cause of bad things, because we live in a broken world because of sin. So we also want to remember that. God works in all things for our good, and that's good news. So to illustrate the ingredients, and I know you guys, most women, I'm sure, guys think about this a little bit. The ingredients that go into a cake, if you make a cake from scratch or anything that you do from scratch, not very tasty when eaten individually. The flour, the sugar, now if you give that to kids, they would love some sugar, a teaspoon or something like that. Shortening, no good. Eggs, you know, 90 years ago, my grandma, born in the late 1800s, you'd be hungry, just go into the chicken house and grab a few eggs and crack them and eat the eggs. And if my grandma had hamburger laid out and he was hungry, you know, it took a lot to, you know, fire up that cook stove to make a hamburger or whatever. You just ate it raw. Something had run and ate it raw. And he lived to be over 75 years of age. And that was really good back then. Grandpa and grandma were married 50 years, and that was in 1972. And not too many couples made it to 50 years in 1972, if you think back at it. Especially if you lived in South Dakota. I don't know about the rest of the world. But anyway, so you add the salt and the baking powder and the spices. Not something you want to eat one ingredient at a time, but you mix it all together and you bake it in the oven, and it comes out perfectly into a delicious cake. Each event in our life is like one ingredient in a cake. It may not seem good by itself, but when mixed by God and mixed with other events, it will surely produce at the end what is good. So God causes all things to work together for good. This means that we can't judge the goodness of God's work until His program is finished. Have you ever been too hasty in testing the not supposed to do that either if there are raw eggs in it now. We know that. But almost always the result is unsatisfactory. And until God's recipe for our lives is complete, we dare not judge God's cooking. So that's the first thing we want to say about these things and all things. And the next life-changing question our text asks is, if God is for us, who can be against us? We've all heard that verse too. The question is not simply, who can be against us? You can answer that one, who's against you? We could say disease, inflation, exhaustion, depression, calamities, earthquakes, hurricanes, drought, flooding, pandemics. You name them. We can easily list our foes, but that's not the question. The question is, first to say, if God is for us, who can be against us? The thrust of the text, since God is for us, Paul is saying that that since God is for us, it really doesn't matter who's against us or what's against us. All our enemies could gang up on us at the same time, and even cooperating together, they would be no match for God. God is for us. And perhaps we should say those four words every morning as we look in the mirror too. God is for us. Or God is for me. That's how God is working all things for good. Then, the question. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? So how far is God willing to go for us in our situation? Does he put any limits on us as far as how much love he's willing to give to us? Well, we know that God has gone to extreme limits for us. He does not spare his son, but sends him to the cross for us, for the love of us. And we shout, God is for us all the time, all the time. So here we go again with those words, all things. Will he not give us all things? Not only all the things of our salvation? Did God save us so that we'd be slaves to worry about all the things of this world? Would he go to the cross for us and then rob us of the joy of living? Why would he go to the cross for us and then turn a deaf ear to our prayers? We can trust his word, all things. God's love is for us. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? The prosecuting attorney in the courtroom turns up the heat with his accusations. Our answer, since God is for us, what other opinion matters? Every voice that accuses us, even our own voice, holds no court in the presence of a God who spared nothing for us. God is for us. Question from verse 34, who is to condemn? Well, we go back to Romans chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There is no one to condemn because God is for us. And the only one who has the right to condemn is Jesus. And he has already answered the question with the offering of his own life. Just think. Sitting next to God is Jesus, the one who died for us. Our defense attorney continues to speak to us. God is for us. Another question, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Paul makes a list in order of increasingly intensity. Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? This list is an exercise in futility and full view of God's love for us. And if we are moved by our sinful nature to believe the intensity of this list, our great God invites us to take another look at his love for us. We die with him to our sin, and we are raised with him. As simple as that. So often we make it so difficult. Nothing, neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in our creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And since nothing can separate us from Christ Jesus, God is for us. Answer to all life-changing situations and the answer to all life-changing questions. Because God is for us, we can rise above every adversity. Not merely that we cope, but that we can conquer. Because nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate us from God. Because of His Son's death and resurrection, we possess all things with Him. And we know this for sure, because God is for us. And because God is for us, we have no questions. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the church. O Lord, we are your people, chosen by your grace to be your own possession and granted mercy upon mercy. Hear your people who cry to you in need and remember us according to the favor you have shown to us in Christ Jesus our Lord. That you would open our hearts to prayer and guide us in this holy conversation so that we may know those things for which we ought to pray and seek them according to His grace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the church may prosper, the good news of Jesus Christ go forth unhindered, and the Spirit bring many into the fellowship of the redeemed. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may grant to us good and faithful pastors to preach and teach the whole counsel of His word, and that we may receive their words with joy and thanksgiving. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may remember our baptism into Christ and live boldly in our vocation as His children, no matter the difficulties of this fallen world, within our families and our neighborhood and throughout the world, and for those celebrating birthdays, Bob Dunker and Adeline Silliman, for those celebrating wedding anniversaries, Christian and Miranda Stein, 11 years. For newly married, Saturday coming up, Douglas and Lori Moore. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may bless our nation and those who govern us, and that we may use the gift of freedom to live holy, upright, and godly lives, to the praise of His glory. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may bless all lawful occupations and professions, and that we may pursue honesty and virtue in all things. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That God's people may recognize the true treasure of the cross and rejoice in the resurrection, pursuing with all their hearts, minds, bodies, and souls the things of His kingdom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the sick may be healed, the troubled granted peace, the grieving comforted, and the dying kept in peace. Especially we pray for Ann Peterson, hospitalized following surgery. Carl Staben, now at the Whiting Nursing Home. Derek Richardson, home from hospital. Lois Smith, continued recuperation from chemo. Don Duff, recovery of hip surgery and pneumonia. The family of Laura Baker, mother of Lori Robinson, and the family of Darlene Moss, friend of the Rossmans. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may grant us generous hearts so that we may honor Him with the worship of our hearts and bring to Him the tithes and offerings that support His work. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may be steadfast and immovable, abiding in Christ and in His word of truth, and that we would be kept from error and delivered from temptation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord may watch over our comings and goings and deliver us safely into the arms of His mercy, in the blessed rest of the faithful, to receive with all the dead in Christ the gift of life everlasting. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Holy God, mighty Lord, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. Hear the prayers of the people who cry to you in their need and who plead to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We pray. Almighty and everlasting God, give us an increase of faith, hope, and love, that receiving what you have promised, we may love what you have commanded. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all Holy Scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may hear so, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your Holy Word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Together, I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously covered me this day, and I pray that you would forgive me all my sins, where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me.
Our Lord, have mercy on us.
wonderful seeing everyone in worship this evening. Natalie, our new Director of Christian Education, has a couple of announcements for us.
All right, so we just did Vacation Bible School virtually. We had about 40-some kids sign up for that. I do have some leftover bags if you know of anyone who might be interested in still doing Vacation Bible School virtually. Those are connected right to our YouTube page. It's really easy to do. Second, we are still doing Summer Sunday School, and the bags for that are located in the back, and you can pick them up as you go if you know of anyone who might be interested in that as well. Third, we have a middle school youth group this Sunday from 4 to 7 p.m. We'll be doing a little pool party. And then fourth, coming up August 14th, it's a Friday night, we're going to do, with the preschool, the kindergarten cottage, we are going to do a movie night on the lawn fundraiser.
Thank you, Madam. Just want to mention that, as it is in the bulletin, we are doing pies for St. Paul's Lutheran School. If you would like a pie, a special pie, call the office or myself. We'll make that special pie and have it here Thursday evening. We'll also have some assorted other items for sale too. And of course, the golf tournament is next Sunday, August 2nd at the Old Dane Golf Course in Dakota City. If you're interested in that, talk to Pastor Sensit. They'll be back after Sunday. Have a good week as you serve the Lord and the word you do.